Welcome you all. Good evening.
Good evening.
This is Ravi Gupta. I am a CEO and founder of Elite Technomedia Private Limited. We have been looking at spreading the ideas of innovations in the education system and various other sectors for last 17 years. We have been publishing a magazine called Digital Learning and have a digital learning portal which reaches to lakhs of people inside India and outside India. And we have been organizing several conferences inside India and outside India to spread the ideas of innovation in the classroom, preschool, school, and higher education, and in several other sectors. Today, we are having this very interesting panel. It's called From Jugaad to Systematic Adoption of Technology. Be better prepared for the future. And in this panel, we are talking to some of the leaders in the higher education sectors from across India. And we are looking at how technological interventions can bring in more systems approach in running in higher education institution and making it more efficient and making it more user friendly, both for the employees of the institution and also for the students of that institutions. So, and specifically this panel becomes much more relevant and much more important in the COVID-19 era, where everything in this globe has got disrupted. And of course, the higher education institution as a entity have also getting a lot of disruption signals. So I will now request each of the panelists to kindly introduce themselves and their institutions, their organizations, so that the audience gets in the context of in what ecosystem your organization and institution is operating in. So let me start with Karan Kumar. I can see him first on the screen. So Karan, welcome here. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi. I hope I'm clearly audible.
Yes.
My name is Karan. I head the IT at OP Jindal Global University, which is located in Sonipat, Haryana, NCR of Delhi. OP Jindal Global University was founded in 2009, around 11 years back, and the flagship course at that time being law. Now, Jindal Global University has grown to different verticals, having 9 schools, 9th one being launched in August 2020. Jindal University houses around over 5,000 students and has a faculty to student ratio of 1:9, which I think is the best in Asia. That's pretty much about me and OP Jindal University. Thank you, Ravi.
Okay, Karan, thanks for the introduction. Welcome to the panel. Now I can see Hemant Sahel on my right. Hemant.
Hi, Ravi. I'm Hemant. I'm the founder and CEO of Colpol. We are a 6.5-year-old education technology company. We provide a comprehensive platform to education institutions to manage right from their administration to academics to some of the more advanced collaboration platform. And we work with some of the best institutions like OP Jindal Global University, Manipal, D.Y. Patil International University, MIT, Pune, and a few others. And our whole aim is technology can be progressively used by the education institution.
Welcome, Hemant. May I request all the speakers to keep your speakers on mute after you have spoken so that we have less noise. Now, may I request Dr. Prabhat Ranjan to please introduce yourself.
Thanks, Ravi. I am Professor Prabhat Ranjan, right now Vice Chancellor of D.Y. Patil International University in Akurdi area of Pune. Before this, I was heading India's technology think tank TIFEC for 5 years. Till 2013 to 2018, where we prepared Technology Vision 2035 for India. And there, actually, we have discussed many areas of how education can be helped with technology, not only today, but in coming years. When I get a chance, probably I'll talk about it. But my campus is old, the university is new, so only 2 years. So we are focused on futuristic technologies. Last year, I launched a computer science engineering program in VT.
Thank you, Dr. Prabhat. May I move next to Mr. Abhay?
Which is one of the most advanced. In fact,
Dr. Prabhat, we are losing your connection. So we may just move on to the next speaker and then we come back to you again. Is that okay? Mr. Abhay Karade, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ravi and Elect for having me here. I represent Sri Vileparle Chelvani Mandal, is a parent trust. Started in pre-independence in 1939. And we have 100 plus schools and colleges in our group. And we have a prestigious NMR University also a part of our group. And that started in 1980s. We have 65,000 students and more than 8,000 faculties on roll visiting and all. Before joining this, I am attached with this group since 2010-11. But before that, I was a CIO for global CIO for Wellspun and Wadia Group. And then I was part of Hewlett Packard for some time. So this is what is my introduction. Thanks.
Great.
Thank you for being.
Thank you, Abhayji, for joining this panel. May I request Balakrishna Rao to please introduce himself.
Hi, good evening. Thanks, Ravi. Thanks for having me here. I am Bala. I actually come from Manipal Group of Institutions. I am the Vice President and Chief Information Officer for Manipal Global. As most of you would know, Manipal is a group of universities and schools in India and outside the country. We have about 30,000 to 35,000 students, with us, both in the country as well as outside the country. About 4,000 odd faculty and 10,000 odd employees in all. And we offer programs, you name it, like for example, medicine, pharmacy, dental, engineering, communication, management, all kinds of programs across our universities and schools. And my role, and I'm part of Manipal Global actually, which is a corporate arm of the education segment of Manipal Group. And I provide technology services, consulting, and digital transformation practices to our education segment in all. That's my job. Thanks for having me here.
Great. Thank you, Bala. Great to have you here. We have an esteemed set of speakers here who have different sets of background. And the first question which I am going to ask the panel is about the COVID-19 situation. It has impacted the overall ecosystem of education. It has affected the institutions, the parents, the children, everyone, the whole economy is affected. Now, in institution, what are the impact you are seeing in your organization, your initial comments, please? So may I start with Karan on this?
Thank you, Dr. Ravi. I believe JG responded fairly quickly to the whole COVID-19 situation before it became a crisis in India. We had asked our students to go back to their schools pretty early, back in March, I think on 13th of March, 10 days before the lockdown was announced by Prime Minister. And a couple of days after that, we started with the online classes. We resumed our operations. One really important aspect that I saw in online classes, which I'd like to share with the panel and the participants is that a few students reached back to us saying with the feedback that that it was very easier for them to talk in a class, to communicate and participate in a class in a virtual medium compared to a physical classroom, which I feel is something positive that we should take through the entire situation. I think it will help in the personal development and growth of a certain set of students, which essentially goes unnoticed. Apart from the teaching and learning, we also have to move all our administrative operations online. So again, I believe has some positives. There's a term that I'd like to call digital OCD, which I think is present in everyone in the panel today. It's about how we conduct ourselves digitally online. Staying at home and working from home has definitely allowed a lot of people to come online who have been hesitant for a long time, because it didn't break the ice. A couple of weeks after the lockdown, a lot of faculty members, a lot of different HODs from different departments had reached out to me asking for different features, which fortunately or unfortunately had been available with us for so long and we had not been using it. So if I were to look at the positives of COVID-19, what the COVID-19 has done for an organization, especially from the IT or technology perspective, it has affected us in a lot of different ways. Back to you, Ravi.
Okay. Thanks, Karan. You have talked about how positive feedback you got about using technology. Dr. Prabhat Ranjan, your experience of dealing with the COVID-19 situation.
So it took all of us by surprise. On 14th March, we asked the students to go back. We had a Foundation Day event and we had to cancel on 13th night. And then we had the lockdown completely. So most of the faculty members were not prepared at home. And there was no way to, you know, do anything. For example, some of them did not have proper internet bandwidth and so on. And there was no way that we could enhance that. It was not a question of money, just the services were not available. So it was all a surprise. So that's the point that we're discussing today is very, very important. So we had to make arrangements with whatever we can. But in certain cases, of course, it has not been possible. Right now, we are trying to finalize conducting of exams as the semester is ending. I'm just collecting data from all of them as to how much part is remaining, what can be done online and what cannot be done online. For example, if I have to do a workshop or a lab, it may not be possible to do online. But part of that, sometimes it's possible to do. For example, we have a design course or a fabrication workshop. Part of that can be done online through software. But as one of the questions that we have been discussing is that some of the faculty members are very fast to pick up these, and some take a lot of time. And so we have to continuously work on them to come back to this. But one more thing that we find is that when some of the faculty members come to office, they're not worried about home issues. But when they're in home, then they have other concerns also at the same time that is bothering them. So overall, given the situation today that we are, for example, I have no help right now, and all the things we have to do ourselves. So basic survival has taken. So overall efficiency right now has gone down. But at the same time, what we are seeing is that we are able to reach out to many students who, for example, did not want to come to classes, but they are comfortable from their home. So you are able to reach out, or the lectures are getting recorded automatically so they can actually see it later on. Because some of them are late risers and they could see it later on. In fact, a lot of such requests are coming. So it's both ways. But overall, I think it has pushed us into using technology in a better way. And I think the country would benefit definitely. And this is a way we can also reach out on large numbers. We don't have to be confined to classrooms. So this is both a plus and minus point. And hopefully it has just pushed us into adapting technology for education. Thank you.
Great. Dr. Prabhat, I think interesting aspect you gave, that those who did not attend the classes are attending now. That's a good point to see. Abhay ji, your experience.
Thank you, Ravi.
Yes.
Am I audible and visible?
Yeah. Just speak loudly.
Okay, great. Yeah, so COVID-19 is definitely a very huge pandemic and huge challenge for the whole world and whole humanity as such. And but we are slightly better off, though in my city in Mumbai, we are a very big hotspot of India right now. But then the way this lockdown has helped us, and with the guidance of our Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji, we are doing quite good, and I'm sure we will be definitely able to succeed. But this COVID has definitely put a lot of many challenges to various industries, especially all the industries, including the education sector. But I see there's a big opportunity in this case. The opportunity in the sense that it has helped us to put a reset button. We used to be behind something, we are always on move, we are always tired, busy with something and all. Now this has given us a reset button, and everyone can really look at how to do the things very differently. And then people, all of us senior people and everyone who is working, can really look at themselves also, how, because this is asking us for a lot of restraint and discipline and all that. If we really bring those qualities in ourselves, it's going to definitely help us a long way. At SVKM, with very visionary leadership and very hardworking and very forward-looking leadership of our Honorable President, SVKM, Sri Amrish Patil ji, who is a Chancellor of NMIS University also, we started investing into technology since 2009-2010. Various technologies are implemented. We are the first implemented SAP. We have almost digitized every processes, right from admission to examination to alumni and the student services and all that. Including, we do have lot many tools which are deployed for online classes as well as for online examination, online assignments and all that. And those tools are really one of that sort. Well, we definitely have planned it much better way because of all that support what we have. So what I see, we could finish our all syllabus well in time. We have finished all our assignments also well in time. We are a very vast group. We are almost 100 plus schools and colleges, right from kindergarten to PhD, from arts and commerce science college to pharma, from engineering to management, a different aspect of different, and these are also controlled by various other governing bodies. But still, we have implemented, and we are at a better position now. But what I see in the new normal, because right now we used to use these all tools as a desirable tool. So let's say online classes as a desirable tools, but with COVID-19, that has become mandatory to use this, and actually it has increased the utilization among all our schools and colleges. Everyone started using it now, and I see that in new normal, when the new normal will, because normal will not be a same like a regular thing. It will be a new normal in which all these tools is going to add, complement all our campuses and all our infrastructure and all. It will definitely sort out many problems related to the real estate availability or the labs availability, because we do have virtual labs also implemented and all that. So I think this is definitely going to give us a boost for a whole education industry as such. Not just the education industry, but the overall India will see a lot of benefit out of once we come out of this crisis. But anyway, we have to be focused very much on getting away from this particular crisis. Thank you, Ravi.
Thank you, Abhay ji. Bala, your impressions, COVID-19 impacted?
Thank you. So a lot of things have been spoken already by the other panelists. So I just want to bring a different perspective here. This pandemic is really global. All of us know how it played out in a very short period of time and the impact that it created. But there's a difference in this situation. The difference is the social distancing part. Now let's step back a while and then decide. Any organization in this time of crisis would think of business continuity plans, right? And they will start playing the runbook of disaster recovery. Runbook, all of us know, is a sequence of action points to be executed at the time of disaster. We are all familiar with the disasters like flood situations, terrorist attacks, maybe an earthquake, so on and so forth. And then when you play out your disaster recovery plan, there is always an alternate option for your office premises, for your schools, your colleges and things like that, where people can actually collectively work together to set up the disaster recovery and restore the business. But in this case, you know, when you run your run book of disaster recovery, you got stuck. You were all found off guard, because the disaster recovery site in this case is your respective homes. All your faculty, all your employees have to work from home. So all your plans of disaster recovery was suddenly, you know, a failure in this typical situation. So that's what I'm precisely trying to say. This has brought in a uniqueness, and therefore now maybe in the disaster recovery run books, we have to kind of bring in this type of bio disasters also, so that you know, we know how to address this situation. Now, all said and done, yeah, we have to respect this virus. We have to respond to the situation proactively. So at Manipal, what we have done quickly, I will just try to mention, because we are also quite big in size and complexity. So, and we address this situation in two parts very quickly, because we don't have enough time to respond to the situation, right? So point number one was, how to enable people to work from home. Now, fundamentally, Manipal had their employees, faculty members, etc., enabled with the computing devices, laptops, etc., and that was pretty much there. And then as Manipal, we had very comprehensive agreements with the kind of partners like Microsoft and so on. And most of our business applications, collaborative and communication tools, etc., were hosted on cloud, and we had a cloud-first policy quite early itself in the technology roadmap. So that really helped us to very seamlessly move our employees, and enable them work from home quite effectively, and they are productive. Maybe there are a few exceptions here and there, but by and large, work from home seamlessly worked for us. And number two, second part in the whole continuity plan is the engagement with the students. As many other panelists said, we have our own learning management platforms. See, we moved into virtual classes quite quickly because we have Microsoft Teams. There are free products available like Zoom and WebEx, etc. So the physical classes got transitioned seamlessly into virtual classes. So that's part one. Now, what is the part two? To supplement the virtual classes, we have to have a learning management platform. We had our own learning management platform which we could roll out. Collaborative apps are there. One of them is Colpol, all of us know. And there are lecture capture tools that were available with us, so we could stream those videos to the students, and if they are unable to attend the class, there is a recorded lesson available for the students. So both in front of enabling the workforce, employee, faculty, working from home, as well as engaging the students, Manipal as of now is in a better position in terms of responding to this COVID-19 situation. But if you ask me whether we are able to conduct examinations, which used to be paper, pencil, or maybe e-pad basis, etc., we are still working on it, because social distancing is the key. And if you have to enable the students to take examinations from their residences, that is some distance to go. So we're working on that, but fundamentally, we have addressed this situation quite effectively as of now.
Great. I think each of you have talked about various technological aspects. So we have Hemant here. Hemant, your views on how COVID-19 impacted the whole university ecosystem.
Thanks, Ravi. So, I think, all the panelists would agree that, technology was always there. It's not that these tools have suddenly come up. You know, these tools have been around for some good time. A lot of good institutions had also invested in these tools earlier, right? So I think one of the biggest things that have changed in these last few weeks is the behavioral inertia and the intent. So what was lacking earlier and which is not lacking now is that intent to adopt these technology and start using them. So it's not that only the academic institutions or their teams were not prepared. If you see, even education technology players like us were not prepared for a huge surge like this. So when suddenly a lot of faculty members, teachers, and students started using our platform, even we started seeing hiccups because we were also not prepared for such a surge, right? And in fact, if you see Zoom and a lot of other players have seen similar challenges. So I think one of the big things, but at the same time, institutions that we work with have been very open to working with us. They have been accommodating, they have understood, learned how to use technology. So I think one of the biggest wins of one of the positive news in this crisis is that education institutional stakeholders and technology companies have come together in a very, very positive way, and that collaboration has started. And I so much hope that this collaboration continues in this way. Second point, which I feel there is a big shift, is that as I speak to a lot of education leaders, where we work, all of them would agree that the processes have become better. See, in a physical world, you always go back to saying, okay, I will go and speak to the person. Okay, I will see once I go back to the campus. Oh, I have come out of the campus now. I will do this later, or we'll see it tomorrow. But now with people working from home, the requirement for better processes has come up. And I think that's again a great news. And in fact, internally as a company itself, we are seeing that the processes have become better. The compliance of the processes have become better. And I so much hope this both the things continue even after this crisis ends and the things get back to them.
Great, Hemant. So since each of us has talked about technological aspects, can we discuss what are the essential technological tools in an institution like yours? Karan.
Thank you, Ravi. Yeah. I won't essentially like to go down to the details of which tool to use and which tool not to use, specifically with the names. I would like to see this problem from a very bird's eye view. When I speak to other colleagues of mine who are doing the same thing in different institutions or different organizations for that matter, there is one question that always comes up, which is, do we use only one platform? Will only one platform be able to suffice all the needs of an organization or an institution? Which I feel the answer is no. Everyone feels that, we can bring in one tool to serve the purposes of every department, which will serve all the use cases that may come up in the university or an organization. But somehow I feel that even if you can adopt one platform, you can have a lot of problems in scaling that platform into different verticals within the organization or within the university. Your process will...
Please speak louder, Karan, or closer to the mic. Yeah.
Is this any better? Is this any better?
Yes, now better.
So what I was saying was, even if we adopt one tool, university-wide or organization-wide, there would still be a lot of problems when you try to scale vertically within your organization. I feel is a very distant dream, but having worked with a few players in the industry, like Qualpol for that matter, I have understood one big aspect of enterprise solutions, that is to be ready with a software solution which can easily scale from one use case to another. So when I speak about Qualpol, let's say for that matter, we all are fairly versed with technology with the software that Qualpol provides. There's a feature called CNC Campus Help Center in Qualpol. We use Qualpol very extensively in our university. It has essentially helped me and my team to really solve a lot of use cases which otherwise you would have taken months to start a software from scratch and build it throughout. So we have to invest in such infrastructure, in such frameworks, which easily help us grow vertically and horizontally inside our organization. Secondly, I believe we should look at things from a way which can reduce our dependency on local files and Excel sheets, which actually runs throughout the university, throughout different universities, different organizations. We need to get on a platform where we can collaborate directly. As the way I look at it, as soon as an Excel sheet comes into the picture, having organization, we have to be on a single platform. We have to identify that single platform where we come and collaborate with all the data that we have. Now, third point that I had, when we speak of data, I would like to say that when we have different software providers or different software in an organization, it is very essential for us to make sure that the data comes together, in the sense that all these softwares are integrated, are interconnected, so that the data comes here, comes at a single place, single source of truth, as we call it in our technology terms. I would like to put one really important saying by Swami Vivekananda. He was asked the question that why one should read a lot of books in one of his speeches, I guess, to which he replied that when you read a book, it essentially impresses in your mind in the form of a dot. And when you read multiple books, multiple dots are impressed, in your mind. And once you have created the habit of reading a lot of books, over time you realize all these dots interconnect with each other in your brain. This is what I feel happens with when you get all your data together. If I have my data of examinations in one place, of attendance in one place, maybe of discipline in one place, maybe of medical in one place, maybe the students going out of the campus or inside the campus in different places, I might not be able to work a lot on that data. When everything is in one place, the data speaks directly to you. Back to you, Ravi.
Great. Karan, your talk about that we should get rid of Excel files which are floating around in the university ecosystem and various other unorganized data structures, they have to get organized. Very important point you have raised. Dr. Prabhat, your opinion about technological tools needed in a university ecosystem?
So I'm an open source evangelist. Right. And so I always prefer to use tools which are open source. So we already had a learning management system implemented at the university, and that I had been using in my earlier university in Gandhinagar at the Raman Institute from 2001. Mm-hmm. I was quite comfortable with that, and I was also in Delhi, we were using the same tool. So that was one where actually we could bring everything together. The Joom allowed us, it is not open source, but we didn't have alternative at this time, which had larger number of participants at one go. So in the webinar you could do, which is a one-way process, you could not see all of them, but Zoom allowed larger number of participants, which we wanted to see in a classroom kind of situation where we could see faces of students. So right now we have been doing that, and then Google has also given the Google Meet, which also has extended the number of users that can be there online. So we are also now shifting to some of that. But at the same time, when we were setting up the university, my focus was on investing on digital infrastructure rather than physical and human infrastructure. And Qualpol has been a partner in this. Actually, we have been using their system, and we are similarly adapting other tools to make sure that the social distancing part, in another way, where we don't see crowds, we don't want the students to come and stand in line paying fees or paying exemption fees, that I wanted it to go away. So we have been trying to get away with the social distancing even much earlier. Mm-hmm. And the third last point I want to make is that the tools that we are using now because of this COVID, which was forced on us suddenly, although I had planned it already, is allowing the students to learn on their own. And the statement I always make, the learning to learn is the most important learning of this century, because the students will have to keep learning on their own, because they cannot simply stay in a job for 30, 40 years after graduating. So that is another thing that has happened. So in terms of tools, I have basically mentioned a few tools, but I try to stick to open source tools as much as possible. Thank you.
Fantastic. Fantastic, Dr. Prabhat. Abhay, your opinion on this?
Yes, thank you, Ravi. I will divide this particular aspect into two, three buckets, in fact. If you look at well-established universities where all applications, all the tools which are already in place, okay, they already taken steps to really move those tools to cloud. They started using SaaS or PaaS or infrastructure as a services. In some cases, they have established their private cloud also. Some of them are using a public cloud. And we at SVKM, we have already moved many of our services to the cloud. And then those are accessible from anywhere, anytime, all that aspect. Especially if you look at our admission, whole admission process is on Salesforce. It's a Salesforce CRM part is utilized for that. If you look at all our examination processes, especially on SAP, SAP and TCS ION. Whole student lifecycle management and campus management is on SAP. So, and then all the virtual labs, which is on the Platify lab, which is a Microsoft lab, and whole online online classes and everything is moved on to Microsoft Teams. Some of the locations we are using WebEx and all that. So from established players, all that is fine because those technologies are in place and they are already moved certain aspect. What is more important, as I said, now utilization will pick up because now it has become a mandatory aspect of it. But the second aspect, which is more important, is what to do with the small institutes, small group of institutes, where they cannot afford to have SAP, they cannot have afford to have these kind of tools and all. So I would definitely suggest here is that, okay, they need to start small. In these COVID days, for next 2 to 3 months' time, what is more important to finish the syllabus, finish the examination, finish the assignments. Most importantly, do the admissions, because unless until admissions are there, there is nothing to happen. So admissions will be more focused and important. So let's have something which is a small, which is a subscription base, which is on a public cloud. There are multiple small tools which are available. One can really go for it with a smaller spending, and those are very user-friendly tools also. Even they can look at Kalpal kind of a solutions. So I think, Malab, they will have to really divide this into what is mandatory, what is must now. Admissions are a must, student academics is must, online classes are must, assignments aspect is must. Virtual labs are really important because they need to conduct virtual labs. With the smallest investment, they should be able to really start it and then grow as and when needed. Because I think, as I told, new normal will be different because these all tools will be utilized in new normal also. At least 30 to 40% of load on the real estate and the current lab infrastructure and all that will reduce with the help of these tools. So this is a longer type of utilization also. So this is what is my suggestion for all those class 2 and class 3 level of institutes and group of institutes. And those who have already done something, they will have to really focus on utilization. They can look at 4.0 technologies like AIML, the cloud analytics, or they can even look for going with advanced RPA technology. We do use RPAs in certain processes. So it actually, what happens in education sector, especially the major cost is a manpower cost. And that's what. And then looking at the student at the center, we'll have to really spend on to the manpower. But what we can really avoid by having these all tools, we can really use those manpower very effectively and efficiently. That would be my suggestion to our education sector. Thank you.
Great, Abhay. Great inputs. I think what you mentioned is that by using of technology, your load on the existing infrastructure, existing labs, might reduce, and that's a good news. Bala, your opinion on this?
Yeah, thanks, yeah. Ravi. Let me put it pretty simple here. Any school or a university will have typically student acquisition process, academic delivery process, and the evaluation and graduation processes. Now, progressive universities and schools, like some of the panelists said here, would have definitely mature systems to cover entirely from enrollment to graduation. But then there are, I am of the opinion that there are large group of institutions and universities who run on desperate systems or traditional Excel sheets and so on. And then, you know, there is no visibility in terms of how the students move, transition from enrollment to graduation. And they still handle very complex scenarios, etc., using very traditional methods. So my suggestion would be to, this is my personal view based on what I've seen so far, is that each and every school, based on their size, complexity of delivery mechanisms and things like that, because it need not be necessarily campus-based delivery. It can be different academic delivery mechanisms, right? It could be distance learning. It could be pure play online. It could be certification programs. So all kinds of deliveries actually require different types of software and applications. So I would suggest the university or the school leadership to sit together and decide a digital strategy for the organization, and maybe a roadmap for immediately next 6 months, and maybe a longer roadmap for next 2 to 3 years. So that would really, because it's not one solution, fit all kind of a scenario, because number of students can vary, and there could be various challenges which is coming from the various geographies and things like that. So I would suggest that number of tools are already available. As the other panelists said, we also use some of the progressive universities have definitely stitched together all these solutions already. They are actually trying to see what are the further value additions we can make in terms of engaging the students and so on. So I would suggest tools apart, what does the university and school first of all need to engage their students and provide that kind of an experience to the students when they are within the portals of the university. So, but very critical to have a digital strategy and then mobility enabled within the organization.
Great. Hemant, your opinion on this issue?
Thanks, Ravi. I think a lot has already been discussed. I just have three key points to mention here. I think, like it's already said, there's no one solution that fits every institution. But some of the key parameters that any institution should look at while they are looking at technology decisions, because technology decisions are always a long-term decision, normally. Whenever, because the amount of time and energy you invest in getting a solution adopted, by default, it becomes a long-term project. Because even if you get the solution, configure it, deliver it, the time it takes for the people to adopt it is always a decently, it can be anywhere between 3 months to an year. So I think one, institutions have to start looking at technologies where the risk of experimentation is low. That as they work and use those technologies, the risk of experimentation should be as low as possible. So which means by default moving away from anything which is on-premise and adopting cloud-based technologies. And anything which has a huge upfront investments should be a big no. It has to be always, there should be a low cost of experimentation. That is one. Second, I think today's generation is a mobile first generation. A lot of people have stopped buying laptops even. So it is important for whatever solution you're using to make sure that there is mobility. And it is not just a mobile version of the websites, but it is a mobile first experience. So that's, I think, second thing which is very important for institutions to think and look at. And third, I think the data security part, because there are a lot of free things available where there is a huge concern around data. I'm not talking about open source technologies. I'm talking about freeware, where there is huge concerns around the data. So I think these are the three things institutions have to definitely think about while they're. And the final thing is their capability to integrate. Because if you look going forward, I think as a company, we have realized that you have to be very open-minded about integrating as many different technologies as your client institution wants. So a lot of times we might have as Coalpol platform, we might have certain capabilities which maybe my client institution does not want to use, and they have some other product in their mind. So as I think education technology players, we have to also stay open-minded and stay, and look at integration as much as possible and be completely driven by the interest of the institution and not just the companies. So that's my thoughts on technology.
Perfect, Hemant. I think, as you mentioned about key, any technological solution has to be interoperable. It has to be able to talk to all other technologies as much as possible. And yeah, if it is sitting in isolation, it will be become a white elephant.
And Ravi, just one quick add-on to this is that it all depends on the mindset of the promoters of these companies. Do they feel insecure when a new product or new technology comes in? And they start defending in front of the institution, no, mine is better, don't take that. I think promoters of these education technologies companies have to become more open-minded and look at more and more integrations.
So now we have set the context, had two rounds of inputs from each of the panel. Now I will be going selective in asking and answering, like having the answers of some of the specific questions. So the next question which I am going to pose is that should we get our own software developed or shall we buy a ready-made solution? So I will request Professor Bala to first answer this.
Yeah. Thanks, Ravi. This has been for quite some time a boardroom question as well, whether you have to have a buy strategy or a build strategy. Okay. So, but there are plus and minus with both approaches. If you start building something in-house, I'll answer this very crisp and keep it very simple. If you start building something in-house and your own legacy, you have the advantage of customizing the solution according to your needs. That's a big plus. And maybe you'll be able to build the solution at a low cost compared to your buying ready-made solutions. So these are the only two pluses that I would see in the build strategy. But then when you build, there are several disadvantages and challenges as well. The flip side of that is that a university or an education organization to attract talents and retain talents in the areas of very unique skills like product design, product development, and engineering teams, etc., will be a very tough ask. Maybe a university will build a fantastic solution one time, but they will not be able to have a clear roadmap, and they can't actually run a longer roadmap at all, because they generally lose sight of the enhancements and the product releases and things like that, keeping the customer expectations on top of their mind. So that's one certain flip side. And I'm also of the opinion that if you build something internally, rather difficult for you to kind of bring in the security elements, the compliance elements, the scale and the volume and complexity. See, in initial time, when you have a lower scale of operations, it might work. But when you scale out, then these parts start breaking out. So that's the problem that I see. So therefore, unless it is very core to your business, it is better to kind of buy the product. And you can even de-risk yourself. Today, the pricing model and the business model of these products are completely different. They are all available as pay-by-use model, software as a service, subscription models, and things like that. When you don't like it, you can actually discontinue and transition to some other product. So best of breed products, buy strategy would be better. I will put my bets on that. I will put my money on building strategy only when that is very, very close to your heart and it is very core to us, and you have an IP inside it. Otherwise, I will not prefer build strategy.
Great. Dr. Prabhat Ranjan, your opinion.
Yes, actually, I agree with Bala. Starting completely from zero is not really something that one should try. The two options we have, one is you completely buy out a solution from third party, or second is being an open source evangelist. You take open source platform and add modules to that as per your need. that is a better solution. And I actually missed out mentioning about one other open source software called Open Broadcasting Software, which I found very useful in giving online lectures, where actually not only simply you have camera looking at you, but you can do many more things. So I would also suggest people to look at that Open Broadcasting Software, OBS. So I would also suggest that don't try to do it from scratch unless it's your core business that you're involved with, but either use existing platform, customize to your needs, or completely buy out the solution. It turns out to be cheaper and much better. Thank you.
So next question I'm going to ask is to who should be given responsibility of managing these systems? Do we need a dedicated manager? How important is this? So I'm going to ask Mr. Hemant on this.
Yeah, so I think this is a very, very important question, Ravi. Because, you know, wherever we have worked, and we have worked with a lot of good institutions in the country, I think the difference between successful implementation of technology versus, failure. And failures are far more in terms of technology adoption in education institutions than successes, right? Especially when you're trying to go beyond the normal. I think the technology teams make the biggest difference. That more than the product, more than anything else, the biggest differentiator in how successfully you are able to adopt technology is the technology teams which are driving these projects. And I think the key factors that differentiate good technology teams from bad technology teams is, one, do they really understand technology? Do they understand the nuances, the depth of technology? So, you know, that's one thing which is very, very important. For example, a lot of times when we are working with OP Jindal Global University, and we're talking to Karan just doesn't tell us the problem. He also tells the solution a lot of times, right? So he says, hey, you know, this is going wrong and this is probably going wrong at your system. Can you guys also, fix this up? So I think understanding technology is very, very important. Second, I think the ability to get hands-on. So I think we should not give the term manager at all to any technology head in the institution. Don't call them as managers at all, because you need people who are hands-on, who have the intent as well as capabilities to go talk to stakeholders, understand their requirements, come back, talk to the technology partners like us and tell what, because see, technology is always generic. You have to have a context to technology. So which is what these technology teams bring. We can't bring that context as technology players. And lastly, I think this whole collaboration between the technology companies and internal technology teams or IT teams has to be collaborative. A lot of time, companies like us are looked upon as vendors that, okay, we just come with a solution, and a lot of times the people managing us are just managing a vendor. So I think that has to change in a big way. And even with the best intentions of the top leadership of an academic institution, if you don't have the right IT teams, they will always struggle despite whatever be the amount of money they are spending on technology. So I think this is the biggest differentiator.
Great, Amit. Great answer. How can we make teachers and staff adopt technology? There is a huge resistance. Not all the faculty members are tech savvy. How to train them? So, Dr. Prabhat Ranjan, your opinion on this?
So, I have mentioned this earlier. There is a wide variation among the faculty members. Some are very much used to technology and so on. But what has improved recently is that as the family members have dispersed across the globe, people have had to adopt the technology even to communicate among themselves. And this has helped some of the technology savviness has increased overall. But still, that training has to be done in some sense. There's a big variation among the faculty members. And we have tried that now. Slowly, we are finding that people are getting used to that. So it's not a very difficult thing, just because the fact that for our daily life, we are now have to, for our family life, for our buying, everything, we are using technology. So slowly that resistance is going down. But what has happened is that everybody is not well prepared for technology infrastructure in the home. So what COVID-19 did was that we all were prepared to do online delivery from the offices in the university. We had rooms and so on. But suddenly we are forced to the corner saying that now you have nothing, you have your home and you have to do everything from there. That was a challenge. So probably that is a challenge that is not going to be there once the systems are a little bit better. So, but otherwise, I feel that this is not a big issue right now. It's just a question of working with faculty members to make sure that they use these tools. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Bala, your opinion.
Oh, this is very relevant. COVID or no COVID, this is very, very relevant. You know, this can be a big showstopper as well for the organization's growth. Now, it takes time, but then, you know, the digital literacy, digital readiness of an individual or an organization makes a big difference in the organization's growth. There is, make no mistake. Now, on one side, technology is disrupting the businesses, the way we work, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, COVID is the best example. That's on the one side. On the other side, we have got a very demanding students, and the current generation of students are completely digital. So their expectations are completely different. We were talking about what software tools to be used, etc., etc. But then mostly the management in the university thinks of delivering something what they feel good. It should be actually the other way around, where what students expect us to deliver them. So it should be completely flipped, in fact, when you design the software and business solutions. Okay, that apart, I have got some suggestions to address this. It will take time, but the suggestion which we are also practicing is that, Dr. Prabhat sir also said that, you know, there is a gap in terms of digital literacy as far as the faculty fraternity is concerned and the staff are concerned. So my suggestion here would be create smaller groups of digital champions or core teams within your universities or schools, and there could be volunteers as well, and you can even co-opt students in those groups. There is nothing wrong, and then perhaps create certain proof of concepts or maybe storytelling, success stories, etc., and try to kind of drive adoption among the rest of the crowd. And there could be, and this can be contagious that way, and others will come and can be onboarded rather easily. So this is one way you can drive adoption within the organization, particularly the education institutions and universities. Secondly, there should be a focused change management drive coming from the top leadership. And it is extremely essential, including the leadership team. Everybody has to go through this change management cycle, because it's all about change of mindset and change of culture. So therefore, these practices are extremely important, and this should be a top-down strategy. Number three is that, you know, you can consider incentivizing some of the super adopters, champions in this area and things like that, and say that he has made a difference actually. And then, and remember, we have to demonstrate the value, and we have to demonstrate what is the difference between having technology and having no technology. So then perhaps if there is a value, whether he is a senior member in the faculty or maybe a junior member in the faculty, value brings that traction and then stickiness also. So that is one way you can incentivize. If that is one approach that you can take. And lastly, many maybe panelists or maybe from the audience, like it or not, let me put it down. This last option is, many companies are actually adopting this strategy. Reverse mentoring. Have students take up certain lessons on digital practices, etc., to the faculty members and staff. So that's called reverse mentoring. So that might also do some tricks for you so that, you know, they have seen the technology. They are the great users of technology, and that might as well help.
Great idea of reverse mentoring, I suppose. Yes, so pushing the other way around the whole thing. When we are talking about adoption of technology and IT, how we are looking at the budgets? So may I ask Mr. Abhay, your perspective of that, how do we estimate how much we need to spend on technology?
Abhay.
Yeah, thank you, Ravi.
Yeah.
I would see education sector works differently than the corporate sector. In the corporate sector, things are well defined, sir, properly over the period of time. You have 3 years plan, 5 years plan. In education, we have also planned for that. But those are mostly academic plans and all that. So there's no IT is such a way it is evolving over the period of time. So I don't think there is a IT strategy kind of a plan which is possible other than the barring these tools which I have spoken already. So I will not put any number to this budget because there are too many stakeholders. Right from if you look at even faculty also. In faculty also you have visiting faculties, adjunct faculties, on-roll faculties, you have students, you have candidate, you have people at other end, your examination partners, your IT vendors and all that. So from a revenue budget perspective, definitely one can look at it. How much we are spending, how much we'll be spending and all that. A revenue budget is very much possible. But on a capex budget, definitely one has to look at case by case. Because finally, what is more important is that when we need to really address it to the management, the top body, keep this tool which I am going to deploy for the university or for the group of schools and colleges, how exactly is going to help organization? What is the value? What is the value for brand management? What is the value for placements? How it is going to increase the placement? How it is going to increase admissions? How it is going to increase the brand value? So all those questions need to be really answered. And those are some of the cases it is intangible. Some of the cases it is the tangible answers also. So it really becomes difficult to put some number. But I would always say that the IT investment need to increase. Why? Because IT tools will play a major role in using the manpower effectively. Just having one RPA tool can actually provide a huge amount of benefit in efficiency management. Having an analytical tool which provides, let's say, NAC report or accreditation reports and all that can provide a lot of time, can actually avoid wasting of a lot of time of the people. So all those aspects, I think, are very, very critical. So I will not put any number here. The things has to be outcome basis and it should benefit the student. And if it is benefiting students, I don't think even parent will also object to a small portion of it is increasing the fees for getting those benefits. So it's basically how we can exactly manage what type of technology, what type of benefits, and how those expenditures can be managed through increasing the fees. Finally, the income source is only fees. So how exactly these to be managed? That's what I think. But I will not put any figure. But I would suggest investment in IT need to increase because IT is going to drive every business. All the disruptions are happening. In India, now we are, thanks to COVID, in fact, we are now looking at increasing all those online aspects so that we can really touch, we can really move to the level of foreign universities and all that. So I think this is very critical and this is very important. Thank you.
Great. May I request Hemant to respond on this page?
Yeah. So I think, this is a conversation we often get with the institutions. And recently, we've been speaking to a lot of institutions because we have got a lot of inquiries. A lot of times they say, no, this is expensive. Or sometimes they say, okay, this is great. It works for our budget. I think one of the things I always bring in a conversation with the academic institutions is that you should always have a lens of return on investment. You should see, we all invest money. Some of us do FDs, some of do mutual bonds, some of us do all different kind of things on investment, right? Based on the kind of risk and return we want, right? So I think in terms of technology as well, each institution has to look at what kind of returns are they looking at. Are they looking for extraordinary results? Are they looking at solving the first level of first order problems? So that's one key thing to keep in mind. Because you cannot have a blanket lens set when you're looking at, because you can say, oh, this product is available for X price, another is for Y price. You have to look at what return are they giving to you. That's one. Second thing, you should also look at what is your appetite, both financially as well as what is your appetite from an adoption perspective. you bring a top-notch product, but you don't have people ready to adopt it, so you are going to burn a lot of money. And I've seen a lot of institutions make that mistake. When you're bringing technology, you should then also look at, like I said, it is most important for institutions to look at their internal team. If they don't, we are doing some very complex integrations at multiple institutions. So if we don't have senior team members like Professor Bala, they would have no clue what's going on. So you need to also ensure they have the right teams, and then also take the decision, you know, products in that context, and then accordingly the budgets will pan out in that context.
As we implement IT more and more, the budgets increase. So how do we recover those budgets? Can we increase the fees? Dr. Ranjan, your opinion on this?
Mostly I've seen that when we implement online tools or other things, we are also saving somewhere else, saving both in terms of physical infrastructure and human infrastructure. So really increasing fees is not needed. Mostly it is a very small percentage of the overall budget that we can easily absorb it. So I don't see that being an issue of how to manage that budget. It's not a problem.
Right. What are the chances for data being misused? How to ensure security? I think it's a genuine concern. So how do you answer this?
I think they say, right, data is the new oil. So you have to make sure the data of your institution is really safe. So three things which, I personally think institutions should do in that case is, one, you know, if you look at, there are some very good, there are some very good guidelines on data policy, especially from the European Union. So try to see if your products are compliant to that you are trying to buy. Second, again, it goes back to a good internal IT team. Make sure your technology leaders understand what security means, because anybody who's trying to sell you a product will tell you all good things about them. So you need to make sure your teams are doing that audit and before they take the decision. For example, initially when we went for a Microsoft integration at OpenGL, we saw some of the concerns, and Karan raised those concerns. Karan said, hey, look, this integration can have these, vulnerabilities. And eventually we sorted it out. And now, we have sorted that particular aspect of it, because see, there's no technology in the world which is 100% safe. So that battle between the builders of technology and the people who are trying to, attack those technologies is a perpetual battle. It doesn't get settled at any point of time. So you have to look at products which are continuously growing. And finally, from a security, I think make sure your contracts with your technology partners are watertight, where institutions are covered and even the technology partners are covered, because it can also happen because of the wrong mistakes from the institution. So make sure you have extremely watertight contracts which bring accountability on both the sides.
Many universities in India, both private and the government, are not yet digital savvy as much they have the scope to be. So how can organizations who have already implemented a lot of it can help them? So may I request Karan to speak about it?
Thank you, Ravi. One very simple way of doing it is by connecting. We obviously do not talk to a lot of people as much as you do, given the kind of work you're doing or the kind of work Hemant is doing for that matter. So one really good way of connecting is through you guys. Maybe we can connect with different universities. Maybe we can get on the same page like we have gotten together right now. And also if possible, maybe we can create a consortium of sort, which is not formalized in India at all, and is available in other countries, which is led by the government of India, which is led by the government of different countries. So there is a possibility of creating a consortium. If I were to think of it, if things go positive, if something of that sort does come up, I think that we can create a small framework of sort which all the universities can use throw out some problems to really smart CS grads who are actually looking to solve real life problems which they do not get in during their curriculum. Throw out some problems to them, let people get on board, solve problems just the way Linux developed, the way software like Moodle developed. We can all get together, get our heads together and get working towards it. Lastly, I'd like to mention another thing is that when I was running a few startups of my own before joining ADU, one thing was really becoming a fad at that time was every company used to just put out the tech stack that they're using to build the product that they are. Similarly, I think us universities can also do the same thing by putting out whatever tools we are using to streamline whatever processes that we are at the universities. Back to you, Ravi.
Great. Karan, I think you have mentioned about developing a tech consortium, which may be helping each other. Fantastic. Bala, your opinion on this?
Yeah. Yeah, mostly I agree with Karan as well, but then I have got some couple of thoughts in my mind. Under the current circumstances, what best we can help other institutions is that as Manipal Global, we can actually help them in their digital transformation journey, creating a roadmap for them and things like that, and help technology consulting. That's one. Two, we can share best practices, what we practice, and then help them kind of adopt that quickly. So sharing of best practices can be done. So I've seen recently a circular from AICTE where they are sharing all technology contents for various engineering institutes and so on. So this sharing and caring is happening, and within Manipal Group itself, we have got multiple medical schools in different geographies, multiple engineering and management schools in different geographies. We have started conducting classes and exchanging contents, lecture notes, PDFs and things like that across our own units. So this practice can be extended to other universities as well. So we understand few things, and then those practices can be shared with the other schools and universities. We're pretty pleasure to involve in such activities.
Fantastic. And just to tell you all that we at ELETS have been bringing out this digital learning magazine and organizing these workshops, conferences all over the country, and also now online with this agenda itself. So I will request each of the panelists to actually write an article about your digital journey and your digital vision for your institution. And we'll be happy to publish it and actually disseminate it as much possible so that it helps the other universities also. And at the last question, briefly, I would like to ask you that the next 4 to 6 weeks are very, very crucial for all the academic institutions because of this COVID situation. So what is your advice to the education stakeholders? So let me start with Dr. Prabhat, briefly, if you can mention.
So the two parts of this process, one is the teaching learning process, but also how do you evaluate the students? And that's a much bigger challenge that one is facing, because all the online examinations that were conducted, still it was in a particular room where people were sitting. And so now that people are distributed all over, that's one of the concerns that we are seeing, that as the semesters are ending, how do we evaluate students? Solutions are coming up, but most of us are not used to that. I would like to add something else which you have not asked, but it will be useful. That when we prepared Technology Vision 2035 for India, actually, we had actually mentioned a few things. And right now, one of the issues is that when we do online lecturing, how do we grab the attention of the students? It's very different compared to somebody give a lecture in a physical face-to-face thing. So open broadcasting software that I mentioned allows one to do some of this, just like TV anchor with the weather map explains weather. Similarly, the teacher can do that. But what we are seeing further is that holography is going to come in a big way. And so we actually envision multilingual holographic systems, which will allow one to reach out. And then actually already the experiments are going on where actually you're directly transferring knowledge to the brain. So that is another experiment that is going on. So there are a few things that are happening that are going to change the complexion of education in a big way. So I'll stop at that point. Thank you.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Abhay, your opinion. Next 4 to 6 weeks.
Yeah, thank you. I think next 4 to 6 week or like it's a 2 to 3 month impact. I see there are unfinished work for many of these education institutes, especially they need to finish the syllabus, they need to conduct the assignments and examinations and all that. What Dr. Prabhat also said, these are the areas where a lot of focus, but a lot of challenges are definitely there. And then very short time, I don't think everyone will be able to really prepare quickly that way. So I would suggest, which I already said, is that start small, start with online classes, start with online assignments, start with online examinations tools on a subscription basis. Okay, and then let's look at this 6 months time somehow. See that how exactly we can really handle this situation. This is the first thing. Second, it may be a philosophical, but second thing which is very, very critical and which is very important, whenever as a country we are faced with challenge, in ancient days also, you know, during this Alexander's accession of India, those days also professors played a very important role in taking out country out of those mess. I would suggest here now, like our doctors are fighting day and night 24 hours, I would request all the professors, all the teachers, all the administrative staff of a college to really explore all the options which are possible to really handle these 4 weeks. It's not some tool is available and it can be implemented immediately. Any tool which will definitely take 6 months time. We don't have 6 months time right now. So any simple tool which is available, go for subscription, implement it. And professors need to really do the same job what they have done anciently for India. They need to spend more time. They need to really look at how they can really help in sorting out. What they can always do, all the computer heads and IT heads of every and every college need to explore all the options which are possible and help organization to come out of this situation. But this is what one can really do it, because the time is too small. If I say something, okay, you can deploy this and you can deploy that, I don't think that is a solution right now. Maybe over the period of time, we can make ourselves ready for such a type of pandemic if it comes in future. But right now, what is important is to explore, find simple solutions, take extra efforts. If faculty need to take extra efforts, if management need to take extra efforts, they will have to put extra effort and see that students will not suffer. It is our prime most important duty to keep students busy, giving them learning what is needed, because we have responsibility of educating this future generation in this pandemic days also. So this is my suggestion. This is my humble request to everyone, every professor, every faculty. Please don't look at time. Now, spend time and get India out of this whole mess. And I'm sure they will do it, because they have done it. They have proven it in past also. Thank you.
Fantastic. Karan, your opinion? Next 4 to 6 weeks, 8 weeks.
Thank you, Ravi. As we all know that we have all moved out of our comfort zones and the normal that had been set for so long has been challenged, and we seem to have adopted whatever we have done in the last 3 to 4 weeks has been fast. We have been moving fast. We have been challenging the set ways, and when we move fast, when we change a lot of things, when we change a lot of established things which are not broken, we do break a lot of things. And when we do that, I feel that it's very necessary to quantify and measure the impact of every decision that we take, be it with technology, be it with academics, be it with examinations. Everything that we're running inside a university, inside any organization for that matter, we have changed a lot of things. I think it's very important to measure what we are breaking right now. And having said that, since we are moving fast, I think we can, this gives us an excuse to move a lot faster. This gives us an excuse to be a lot more aggressive in our approach, within our organizations or universities while fighting with COVID-19, while trying out new things. It gives us a chance to run more experiments and again measure. That is generally what we do when we build, new products and put it out to the market. We experiment a lot. This is the time that we can experiment a lot. I saw a question in the chat box saying how we can conduct examinations. I remember there have been a lot of meetings, internal meetings at Jindal that we have had about doing more application-driven examinations, maybe more research papers, maybe to understand, to gauge what a student has actually learned and if he or she can apply the principles of what he or she has learned instead of a theoretical paper. That is the experiments that I'm talking about. We need to experiment. We need to get back to those minutes. We need to experiment more. We need to measure a lot. And I'm sure when we are back to our physical campuses, physical classrooms, we would have learned a lot from these exercises that we are doing right now. There is quite a lot of chance that we might just take some things that we experienced during these couple of months of lockdown, of COVID crisis. And maybe the physical campus experience will not remain the same. So it's just about measuring right now.
Thank you. Bala, your views on this situation.
Yeah, thanks, Ravi. As Karan said, we are learning new ways of working and that's happening very quickly and it is not an option anymore. And I'm also of the opinion that once the lockdown gets released or relaxed, a lot of things might prevail as well in terms of campus deliveries, etc. Might continue to be 30-40% online even after the lockdown is relaxed. So these digital practices and digital economy will stay and then it will grow as well. That is for sure. So one thing that we have to do, this might look like a bit of an English, but it's not good on our part to play a waiting game. We have to start thinking digital. We have to start going digital as well. And then we have to quickly use this opportunity to create some immediate term and medium term plans to execute and have rigor in terms of executing those plans. So that's what we need to exactly do in the kind of months to come.
Fantastic. Hemant, you can give the last comments on the next 4 to 6 weeks or right. 2 months, 3 months. Yeah.
Thank you, Ravi. So I think that I would like to speak about few very important parameters institutions should be thinking about. I think one, while they are taking the technology decisions, it is very important to look at the simplicity and use of ease of use. Most of the faculty members, students are very used to using Facebook, WhatsApp, and these tools. So you have to look at are the technologies that the decisions that you are taking. One of the biggest factors behind taking those decisions should be, are they easy and simple to use? Will my faculty and students be able to start using it immediately? I think that's a very important thing institutions have to keep in mind while they are taking this decision. The second, there is a human side to technology, right? Technology means nothing without the humans who are using it. So while there is a huge rush for institutions and their leaders to go to the Facebook and the social medias and post pictures and say that, my university has gone online, people are sharing screenshots of Zoom, that's the easiest thing to do. I don't think there's anything to show off there. Doing a Zoom class and taking a screenshot and putting it on Facebook and LinkedIn is the most easiest thing to do. So I think it is important for education leaders to go back to their teachers, go back to their students, take feedback, understand where they are getting challenged, where there is a, you know, where are the gaps, and, you know, have that empathy that everybody is going through this journey together. So make sure that you are listening to them and resolving their issues. Third, and the last thing is that do not again think short term. The same mistake which institutions have been doing earlier. If you look at a lot of institutions did not invest in technology thinking we don't need it right now, which an avoidable thing. If you again do that mistake now by just thinking of, oh, how can I just complete my classes by free Zoom, or how can I just complete my examination by something, you will again be in the same, you know, fall in the same trap. So this is the time to also think long term, and they don't really, the long term thinking and short term thinking doesn't need to be separate. They can be very well connected, and it is the right time to start thinking of technology as a long term partner and make the right decisions. And that's what I think institutions should be doing or thinking about.
Perfect. So I have looked at the question and answers, and like there are most of the questions have been touched upon by the panelists and each of us. And if there are others which are remaining, I will request the people to, I have like written my email ID here. Most of the speakers are on social media, easily accessible. But if you have a difficulty in accessing them, I'm requesting the audience to send me the question and I will forward it. And also many of you are asking that how do I increase our digital readiness? How do I implement technology? So just to inform you that we at ELETS and Digital Learning are doing every week one webinar like this on IT and digital for higher education, and also one for schools. So every week we are doing. So you can check out our digital learning and ELETS pages on Facebook and LinkedIn and Twitter, and you can see the information there, and you can actually attend these webinars. And I again request you all to please like and share this video, very informative video. We have excellent panel of huge experience with us here in this panel, and I think I have learned a lot personally after attending this panel itself. So may I request each of the audience that we close it here, since we are already delayed. And thank you all, esteemed panelists. Thank you, Karan. Thank you, Hemant. Thank you, Dr.
Thanks, Kumar. Ravi. Thanks, Ravi.
Thank you, Abhayji. Thank you, Bala. Amazing.
Thank you, so thank you. Thank you all.
You all have.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye.